Hello guys, my name is Rehan and welcome to an episode of Ray Talks where we're going to talk about gaming and how one can earn money for it. So gaming, as we all know, is meant for fun, enjoyment, pleasure, everything. But how many of y'all knew ki one can earn money through gaming? And wouldn't it be amazing to earn money through the thing that you love and make a career in it? So joining me today to talk about this, the same, is Clinton Mendoza, an architect by profession, but a gamer by heart. So welcome, Clinton.
Welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, so let's get straight to the point. We'll talk about gaming as an industry in itself. So gaming is one of, if not the largest, is one of the largest industries. And to give you some stats, the International 2019 Esports Tournament had a prize pool of $34.3 million. The Fortnite World Cup Finals 2019 had a prize pool of $30.4 million. So looking at these stats, you know ki it's a pretty huge industry. And that's how you earn money. Basically, you play in these tournaments and you can earn. And that's what's called esports. So basically, there's CSGO, there's Valorant, there's Fortnite, there's Dota 2. There's a lot of these games in sports, and a lot of games keep coming up each year after year. So what do you have to say about the rise in these esports tournaments? Like there are games coming up every year. There are tournaments coming up. What do you have to say about the rise in these tournaments? And especially due to COVID, there has been a substantial amount of rise in the number of tournaments.
Yeah, I do agree that COVID has been a good factor in order to keep people going into games. But I believe in the last 10 years also, there's been an upward trend of games happening. There's a lot of launches. Games always have been launching. Every year you have new games coming out. But there is this competitive scene, or this competitive nature of gaming, especially multiplayer gaming, battle royales, 1v1 shooters, which are picking up. And the online gaming industry is becoming more and more popular. COVID has definitely added to the whole, because you have more time in your hands, you're working from home, everyone's at home, so you can catch up with even other friends, other people. So yeah, it is an upward trend, and it's rising. Even I was gaming earlier when I was a kid, and then I stopped, and thanks to COVID, I got back to it.
Yeah, a lot of people got back to gaming. So talking about esports, especially in India, even in India, esports has been on the rise, not only because of COVID, but even before COVID. And I think PUBG Mobile was a big factor in esports on the rise in India, because in India, not everyone can afford like expensive PCs or laptops that cost about 50,000, or they cost more than 50,000 actually. So a normal exactly. Indian consumer spends about 10,000 or 15,000 on a basic mobile, on a smartphone, Android phone, and he can start gaming.
Exactly. Yeah, that's true. I mean, yeah, I've seen this crazy trend of mobile gaming that's happening. And mobiles are the most accessible way of gaming, because earlier on, you would have to spend a lot of money on either a PlayStation or a PC or something that could give you the graphic performance. But now even the cheapest mobile can support a lot of gaming, and that's why the industry in India at least has really picked up from PUBG, Fortnite, all these games that you can play on your phone. You can play on the go. It's not even necessary that you need to now go home and sit on your couch and play a game. I've seen people playing PUBG on the trains and while driving, like in cars, and also it's become a very accessible thing to do, and it doesn't need to be something that's a leisure activity only, or something that's reserved to 2 hours of your day. So all of this is how and why I think India, I mean, India, it's not like because of the mobile, it's a rise definitely. But I remember in my childhood days back in India, we used to have cyber cafes, and we used to have a lot of these other shops that you can just go and take a bunch of friends along and just play for an hour or two. So it's always been a trend, but it's become more accessible now.
Even the graphics on mobile aren't that bad, and only thing you need is a good internet connection. That's it. And you're good.
In fact, now you can even connect a controller to your phone, and you can connect your phone to a display. So it's not like you're even gaming on a small device anymore.
And there are so many new phones coming up with whatnot. Good processors.
Yeah, there are like
graphics.
dedicated phones.
Yeah,
phones
gaming
dedicated
phones.
To only gaming.
Yeah. True. And there are so many esports players that have come up through PUBG. There's Mortal, there's Scout, and a lot of other players. And even PC May India has been there. There's Aktiv Fun. There are a lot of esports teams. Prior CSGO ke time pe, there were a lot of teams competing, and now Valorant also a lot of teams have come up and they're competing in tournaments. So in India, SA2L sold a team, won 30 lakh rupees from a tournament for, that was PUBG Mobile India Series 2019. They won 30 lakh rupees. So yeah, that's huge.
That's huge. Yeah, that's great. And yeah, I mean, These tournaments do have a lot of money in them, and it's just an untapped sport that India is not yet being able to. Like, we have a lot of people who are interested. We just need the right kind of boost and support from people, like how like athletics and how Olympics and all is supported by the government. I think we need more support in order to take esports forward. And we have a lot of enthusiastic people waiting to try it out.
Talking about the government, you said government. Recently, on the 4th of February, the government of India in the Lok Sabha, Jagdambika Pal, a member of Lok Sabha, raised a few questions pertaining to gaming and the esports policy in India. So that's also a huge thing. The question she asked was, I'll read it out, whether the government has any plan to introduce gaming and esports policy in the country, whether the government has any plans to bring the sports and gaming in the concurrent list of the constitution, and what are the government's estimates on the size and value of the gaming industry in India? And the sports, youth sports minister also answered all of these questions, saying it's an untapped sport and it's completely skill-based. So yeah, and there are a lot of federations also in India that are looking into this. There is ESFI, that is the Electronic Sports Federation of India. So yeah.
Oh, really? I don't know this federation, but yeah, it's good. I think we need to make it like a national thing and be able to, on a national level, be able to join these competitions and be able to participate in these sports events. I'm sure even internally, we have a lot of events, but none of them are driven like by governments or being represented. You can't represent India, basically. So that would be great.
But when the government comes in, it will be like a huge boost for the Indian market. And also, if in future, I'm sure we'll get to see this, teams representing India and participating in esports tournaments there, it would be fun to see like an India versus Australia or India versus USA participating
that's
in a particular game. And I don't think that's far away. It should.
Yeah, because a lot of these even individual esports streamers, right? There are a lot of these like open sourced or not driven by multinational company, but they launch events and they have these esports events and they have a crazy amount of views. So it's not like, oh, nobody watches esports and gaming is only to be played and not to be watched. There are a lot of people watching esports and interested in esports as a mode of entertainment also. So it's again, as you said, an untapped territory that we need to boost.
Another way through that you can earn money through gaming is content creation. So you can make videos of your gameplay. You can live stream the games that you play. You can make commentary videos. You can post gaming news and whatnot. It all depends on creativity. Creativity plays like a huge part in content creation.
So regarding content creation, which plays a very important part in gaming and the gaming industry and to boost people to like take up gaming, because like, why would you want to watch these content creation courses? Because it's not easy to develop the skills that you require to play a game. So watching these people will make you understand how it's played, give you some hacks, give you some tips, give you some tricks. So that's the first reason why. And it's a very popular thing. Like, anyone who plays a game knows that they have favorite people that they follow. And it also boosts a lot of games that people don't know. So in the case of chess, so East Chess was something that is very popular, but not a lot of people know about it. And it was made famous by this one content creator from YouTube called Samay Raina, who's a stand-up comedian, but he has a lot of followers. And yeah, so he kind of boosted the community. He brought in people from the chess community into his stream. He also hosted some competitions between like chess players and comedians, and all of this content kind of made people more aware and has like also boosted the people interested in joining the whole e-chess sport.
Even me, after watching his stream, even I started playing chess. I had no idea what chess was and what piece moves were. But after watching his stream, I was really intrigued on learning chess. So a lot of the esports players that we talked about before are into content creation. There's Shroud, there's not only esports players, but other people also are into content creation, like PewDiePie, there's Carrie Minati from India and all. So how exactly can you earn money by content creation? So first way is the platforms itself on what you stream, they give you an opportunity to earn money. If, for example, if you stream on YouTube, there's Super Chats, there is an option to take memberships to the streamer that you like. And of course, Google AdSense is there. Even on Twitch, I guess there's, you can gift members, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah, you can gift members. You can monetize your videos. So based on views, Twitch will pay you. And yeah, there are ways to.
The second way would be, I guess, sponsors.
Sponsorships.
Yeah. There are big companies involved in sponsorships. If I'm not wrong, the Ninja is associated with Red Bull. Red Bull is a sponsor. And there are a lot of people who sponsor these gamers to have their company name on the stream and all.
Gaming peripherals, the people who make like PCs and all these electronics that are used for gaming, they all like sponsor gamers in order to boost their products. So yeah, through sponsorship.
Yeah. The third is the game developers themselves. In order to publicize their game, they pay these content creators to put videos or stream those particular games on their respective channels. You and me, during March, we started playing this game called as Hyperscape, right? And it wasn't that known, but a lot of
it just launched.
Yeah, and a lot of these streamers, the Hyperscape themselves paid these streamers to play the game day in and day out.
Right. Yeah, which kind of boosted the game and got everyone interested again. And so we also saw an upward trend of lobbies, like because you have to join a lobby and you need 100 people in order for the game to start. So initially there were only like 20, 30, 40. But by the days and when these content creators started putting out their content, you did see like this upward trend of people like used to get full lobbies to play. So yeah, these do play a very important role in publicizing a game and making it known to the public. In fact, I just looked outside my window and I just saw a bus move with the Cyberpunk advertisement. So yeah, it's quite prevalent.
Gonna ask you a personal question. Yeah. Who is your favorite gaming creator? Who's your
content creator? So content creation depends on each game. So every game has like different people who are known for that, for playing that particular game. So based on the games I see, there are a lot of people that are, so I can't really subjectively tell you which is my favorite one. But overall, I would say Dr. Disrespect is one person that I've thoroughly enjoyed. Like more than seeing him for him playing a game, it's his theatrics and his antics that, and his whole setup of his, like his setup is crazy. He has like crazy studios and a green screen and everything. So it's, he's one of the most known gamers and most also sponsored and controversial also. He's done like he's been banned off Twitch and he's done some stuff, so yeah, I think Dr. Disrespect for me
at the end of the day is super entertaining.
Yeah, that's right, exactly. And then when you're looking at streaming, like these streaming services, you do want entertainment also, so I think he's the full package and he has skills. So
I hope a lot of our viewers didn't know about all of this stuff and they got to learn something new. That's what I hope. Any last words that you would like to give to our fans, tell our viewers?
Yeah, that game on. You should always try gaming. Some mode of gaming is always good. And it's not only like fun and leisure and wasting your time, as some people call it, but it also increases productivity, increases your focus, increases your hand-eye coordination. So if those things matter to you and is useful to you, then you should take up gaming if you're not already.
Thanks a lot, Clinton. It was lovely having you here. Thanks a lot for joining us. And
Thank
a
you.
special thanks to our teacher, Gayatri ma'am, who gave us this opportunity to try something new. This is not something that I have tried, but I got to try something new. It was an amazing learning. Thanks a lot.
Me too.
Thank you, Clinton. It was nice having you. Thank you.
Thank you.
And to all of you viewers watching, do drop in your valuable feedback in the comment section and let us know if you want to see more of us in the future. Thank you. Bye-bye.